Hey, Jim Bergman with measureQuick. Wanted to take a few minutes today and go over manometers because we have a ton of them and people are always calling and saying, which one should I get? So let's just zoom in here a little bit and just to go over really high level. I mean, we have dual port manometers. That means they have a positive and pressure port. These are usually measuring differential pressure. We have single port manometers like this Fieldpiece, and these measure usually a single pressure only. Now there are open to atmosphere on the other side. So basically what you'd have is this positive port on this Testo manometer is equivalent to this single port on here. And it's, again, the other side's measuring atmospheric pressure. Now you go, well, why would they do that? Why would you have a single port? Well, the real simple answer is just to make it easier to manage hose. If you have two long hoses off this, it can be harder to manage. So they make a single port so you can put one down here and one up there and just make it a little bit more flexible. And then we've got on here also manometers that have displays, like this is a little yellow jacket manometer, differential pressure manometer, and we have some here like the JB, and the JB also has an integrated display in there, right? So very easy to use. The JB is pretty cool because we can tell it what the mapping is. So here, this one's return pressure here, and then up here at the top here, you can see this one has an SP in it, says supply pressure, so we can do the supply and return pressure. As soon as we turn them on, we know where they go, right? So very easy to do. Now these also have integrated static pressure tips, and so do the, a lot of the manometers come with them, even like the CPS manometers we don't have on here. But the static pressure tip is just a little different from a pitot tube in that the end of it is solid. So it's only measuring the static pressure and it's measuring it through these little holes on here. And static pressure is sort of like bursting pressure on a balloon. So when we're measuring the pressure in the duct, there's a pressure flow relationship. That's where you use like a total external static pressure table to measure the static pressure, total external static pressure, and then get the flow. Now on measureQuick, when we're using dual probes like this, when we use one in a supply and one in a return, what's really slick with that is we can do the air side diagnostics individually. So I can look at the return side, I can look at the supply side, not only figure out what the total external static pressure is, but also what side of the system the problem's on if there is one. So that's what makes those really handy. Now all these manometers, whether you're talking about Testo or Fieldpiece or JB, they all have some different features. But all of these, the challenge with them is they drift a little bit. Now JB uses the temperature compensation circuit in there, so there's tend to drift a little bit less. But two things we have to understand on these manometers is their resolution, which means how much pressure change can we resolve. So resolution and accuracy. And so all these are really accurate. The question is, what can we resolve to? So this manometer here, if you look at this closely, you'll see sometimes it's going between 0 and 0.02. So that's your tenths and hundredths spot on here. This is really only accurate into the tenths range. If we double click this, I'm gonna double click the power button, it'll zero that manometer out and we can read in the hundredths, but it's really not as accurate in a hundredths place as, let's say, this manometer is here, which is a DG-8, TEC DG-8. This is probably my favorite manometer, but it's also by far the most expensive manometer. I mean, you're talking probably about a $500-$600 manometer here versus something that might be $150. So you do get what you pay for, but there, it's again, it's about accuracy and resolution. If I want to do like airflow testing with a TruFlow grid, I've got to have something like the TEC DG-8 to do that. If I just want to measure static pressure or gas pressure, well, a manometer like this works fine. So on all these, a couple of things you got to realize when you're using a manometer like this. Obviously, placement's very important. The static pressure tip usually gets placed in direction of flow. So if you look at this tip right here, there's an arrow on the back here that tells us what direction the static pressure tip is flowing. As long as it's perpendicular to the airstream, you're fine. So typically what we do is put it in here and the air is coming in from this direction in. So we would point that arrow towards the flow or away from the flow. Doesn't matter either way, as long as it's parallel to the air going in there. And what we're trying to get is measure that bursting pressure. In the case on the return, it's how hard is it sucking in or pulling in. It's the negative pressure we're achieving on the return, the positive pressure we're achieving on the supply. But in a nutshell, just to recap all this, all these manometers will work with measureQuick. What you need to understand when you buy one is what is the range, the resolution you need to measure with. For most things that you're going to do in this industry, like incoming gas pressure, outgoing gas pressure, static pressure, total external static pressure, any one of these simple manometers, the Testo, the Fieldpiece, the JB, the Yellow Jacket, CPS, they'll all do the job. If you want to measure with very high resolution and you want a very high accuracy and you want no drift, then you're going to a TEC DG-8 manometer to get that. But all of them do the same thing. They measure pressure or differential pressure, and that's all there is to it. Now in the measureQuick app, one thing you do need to understand is in the measureQuick app, and we'll just open up one of these here, we'll go to the probe manager. You can see right now that this manometer is reading a supply static pressure, and it's reading 0.2 inches. And the fan's off on here. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna tap this button and I'm gonna zero that out. And so now the manometer's zeroed, and you can see it zeroed here, and then I can also zero it on the spot. Now once they're both zeroed at the same place, whenever I use this manometer, all I need to do is just tap the button on there, it'll flash blue and zero. Every one of these manometers has a zeroing process, except for the TEC DG-8, it auto zeros. So you'll hear that click periodically. That clicking is it's going through an auto zero process on there. But you do have to follow the manufacturer's directions and zero the manometer, then zero it measureQuick. And then going forward, because you have this true zero, you just have to zero the manometer before you use it. The other thing that you want to watch with these is whatever position you zero it in, it's the position you want to hang it. So ideally I'll hang it, zero it right here. If I change the position just to a horizontal position, it could influence the diaphragm on there. It just depends on the resolution of the manometer if you'll see it or not. But ideally you want to zero it and keep it in the same position. Joe likes to turn these upside down. It's just a preference on there so the hose doesn't kink off. So that's also a good way of using them. But however you want to use them, you can use them as long as you don't reposition them once you zero them. And that's pretty much it. Pretty simple to use. Just pick the one you want and go to town.